Hello everyone, welcome to today's Novedge webinar, The Benefits of Vectorworks 2020. There is always a new version around mid-September of Vectorworks, and it's usually as a burst of marketing about the new features. It's not the new features that Jonathan is worried about though, it's the new benefits. Are the new features of Vectorworks adding to your workflow? Do they increase productivity? There are new features like direct list editing, improved animation, and data visualization. How do these work? Are they a benefit? Dot, dot, dot. And that's what we're going to find out in a few minutes. Let me tell you a little bit about Jonathan. Jonathan Pickup is an architect trained in New Zealand and in the UK with more than 30 years of experience. And he has been writing and producing Vectorworks manuals and providing customer support for more than 15 years. His company, ArchonCAD, is the premier provider of third-party manuals and training resources for Vectorworks. He also runs the Vectorworks Online User Group and provides its main direction. Now, let me show you where we come in. This is Novedge private page where we feature all the Vectorworks product. Novedge is changing the way designers purchase 3D software, offering more choices, more freedom, best advice, faster service, and no headaches. Check us out at novedge.com. And I want to remind you, you can always find us on all the social media. The most common out there. And today's webinar is free and it's been recorded, so you can watch it again on our YouTube channel, novedge.com, YouTube/novedge. And now, without further ado, I'm going to switch to Jonathan's screen.
Show my screen, and there should be Vectorworks.
Yep.
Sweet. Well, kia ora, everybody. So we're going to have a look at the what I think are the benefits. In other words, what are the things that make you more productive? Because as Barbara said in that great introduction, there's always new features. But to me, the features aren't a benefit to you unless they actually improve your workflow or improve your way of working. One of the reasons that this webinar is a little bit later than normal, because normally we do this October, early, middle October, early October, is that it actually took me a while to get used to some of these new ways of working. And to start with, I wasn't sure that they were a real benefit. So, for example, the door and window objects, if you have a look at my screen, we've got this new thing on the object info palette called a widget where you can actually turn the little arrows down. And at first I thought this was just a little bit of window dressing, a little bit of decoration, but actually it's turned out to be really useful. I use these a lot now. And one of the things I did notice when I went from Vectorworks 2020 back to Vectorworks 2019 was that there were some things that I really missed. And this is one of those things that I really missed. It was this ability to have all the information turned off, but just to turn on one object and find it easily. Whereas if you turned all of these on, you'd have to use your mouse wheel, you'd have to scroll up and down for ages to try and find what you're looking for. But I found that was really useful. Let's talk about some of the things that Vectorworks are very keen on. The door settings, they've got a new door style, which is called a barn door. It's not one that I use a lot, but it's what you might call a face sliding door. So in other words, this slides past the face of your wall. So if you put that in a wall, you can actually see that sliding past the face of your wall. So if we put a wall in and we put that door on the wall, I'll just move that over there, which the wall highlights. So you can see there, the door actually opens past the face of the wall, which if you need it is really, really handy. And if you've been looking for this kind of door, it's a real bonus. The other thing that's changed, which we'll come back to in a little bit, is that doors and windows have this ability to have their detail turned on and off. But before we get into that, I wanted to look at some of the fun stuff. So one of the things that's changed is Vectorworks' history with 3D objects. Now you probably all know that in the past you could quite easily draw a rectangle, extrude it, and then do some modeling on it. For example, we could use some of the 3D tools like the fillet tool. Here it is, the fillet edge. And let's give that a decent size. And let's click on some of these edges. And if I choose those edges and enter, so that's a fillet. Now, in Vectorworks 2019, if you wanted to change the shape of the rectangle, then it was impossible. Well, it wasn't easy to go back. Actually, there was a workaround. If you just ungrouped it, it would, you'd actually get rid of the fillet anyway. But let's go back to this. So I'm going to do a couple of operations here. I'm going to shell the inside of this as well. So we're going to make this like a little building, shell the inside. And then you change your mind and you say, well, actually, I don't like the fillet edge up here, so I want to change it. So then what's new is the ability that you can double click on this and you can actually step inside the shell. I can double click it again and I can then use, I'll just get rid of that. I can then use other tools like the push-pull tool. And I can change the shape of my object. So I can change the shape there. I can pull that out here. Then I go, let's fillet that again. Now what you will notice when I've changed it, actually didn't fillet all the edges again. Because I changed the shape of that in that way, it changed some of those edges. Let's go back. Let's double click on this object now. And now let's change the shape of this. Exit the extrude. Exit the fillet, and you'll notice that again, I've actually lost a couple of those edges. So they do talk about this history, this ability to go back in history and see the object. I've got my shell, but I've actually lost a couple of my fillet edges. There are some operations that just don't remember the history, things like taper face. If I taper that and then try and go back in the history, there is no history for that thing. So well, while there's a history for some objects, there is some limitation to it. Now let's go back to where we were here. I want to go right back to the beginning. Okay, so I've shelled my object. Let's double click on this edge. Let's double click here. Now I'm going to do a solid addition. So that's now a solid addition. When I exit my fillet, you'll notice that my new object that I added on doesn't fillet. And when I come out completely, I get a message to say that it's failed. So there are some limitations to this history. So be careful, don't expect it to do everything. There is a workaround with some of these things where if you just ungroup the object, you can get rid of it. So I got rid of the shell solid by ungrouping. I can ungroup it again. I'm just using a keyboard shortcut to ungroup it. And you can see I got rid of the fillet and then I can redo it. That's not quite the same. That's actually just stepping back in time. But so that's not the history that they're talking about. They have improved rendering, which has made it a lot faster for doing your 3D modeling. But one of the things I did want to talk about is this ability now in your navigation palette and in lists to edit the names of things. So let's go back to my, got my layers here. You'll notice that when I go near my floor one layer, I get a little pencil. This is editing. So I can change the name of this and I could call that site model without having to go into the dialog box, without having to make changes to, because normally the way to do it would be to go right click, choose edit, it would open up the dialog box, and then I could bring it up here and spell it correctly, I guess. That used to be the old way to do it. We can now do it there. The other place you can do it, which I found really handy, was the ability to edit things like class names directly here without having to open them. One of the things I do a lot is duplicating classes. So let's say door, let's duplicate door arrow. So it's door, we'll choose the arrow and I'll right click, I'll duplicate that. And then I can directly edit it and I can get rid of the door arrow and I can give it a different name. Like that. So that becomes quite handy. Of course, what you don't get is the difference between if I go right click and go edit, I can edit the entire name. So I could actually get rid of the word standard and I could say arrow 2 or arrow internal. You can't do that through your list editing. But if it just wanted to change a part of that, then it's real easy. You can just click there or you can click on the name and change it that way. So I found that was really handy and that was one of the things I went back to 2019 recently and those are one of the, that was one of the things that I really missed. This, they call it the list browser editing. Now while we're talking about this, one of the questions I saw on the tech board, it's got nothing to do with 2020, but people didn't know that they could use visibilities and they can actually change the classes that are available in viewports just by ticking this box up here. So if you've ever wanted to turn a class off for every viewport that you created, don't forget you can do that. Not new in 2020, it's not a benefit, so I apologize if that's going over old ground. So let's okay that. So I've got a list of things that I want to go through, and they're on my other screen, so I'm going to just go through those. There was one called batch rename, which I thought was quite useful. Sometimes I get classes in that I want to change the names of, and so you can see I've got lots of classes with the name door at the front. I could, if I want to, get rid of those. I could put a prefix in the front of them. I can edit classes. I can edit sheet layers. I can edit design layers. And so if you've imported information from a consultant, you might want to use this. We can rename wall styles, for example. I don't know if I've got any wall styles in here. We can add prefix. We can add a suffix. We can find and replace. So we could actually find wall names and replace them. We could find class names and replace them. So this is a real benefit for managing Vectorworks. So I guess one of the things I should say right at the beginning is a lot of the benefits that I want to talk about today are not benefits for new users. They're not for people who are new with Vectorworks. I found a lot of these changes, particularly the ones I'm going to focus on, that more advanced users, things like data visualization. I actually use them a lot, but I think if you're a true beginner, you might find that just a little bit complex. I noticed a lot of names here, people you're very familiar with Vectorworks, so you should find these things really useful. So I think that the batch rename, it's one of those techniques I think it's going to be a real benefit, but I'm not going to use it every day, but every once in a while I'm going to need it. It's going to be so useful. I just got some floating palettes, I'll get rid of those. So it's not confusing. So we talked about the widget on the object info palette. I found that was really useful. Another thing that I found really useful was when I publish. So let's go up to here and we publish. I've got here a whole lot of PDFs that I want to publish. Straightforward, been able to do this before. But what's new in 2020 is this ability to change the file size reduction. So this particular project you can see on the screen, I've printed this with no reduction. Came out about 15 megabytes for an entire set of sheet layers. I changed it to maximum, so the lowest image quality came out at 5 megabytes. So that's a big change between what we used to do in Vectorworks 2019 and what we can do now. So if you're having trouble creating and you end up creating really large PDFs, this is a real benefit, because what you can do is you can change the maximum file reduction. You can then compress the file, compress the PDF, makes it much easier to upload, much easier to email. There are jobs where you're just going to end up with a large PDF anyway. In that case, why not make sure you're using something like Vectorworks Cloud Services for sharing the file, or Dropbox, or OneDrive, or Google Drive. There's loads of different things you can use. So we've done that. And that then, when I publish it, that will then control the publication of those files. So I think that's quite useful. Let's have a look, I'm just going through my list. I've got some fun stuff I want to talk about. Importing Revit files. Yeah, so we can import Revit files, that's good. But the other thing I wanted to mention was this import of the IFC, which I thought was really useful. When we import an IFC, I thought it was really useful that we could reference it. And we can also choose which parts we want to reference. So we can bring those in, and when we reference those in, it brings in my file. Let's just have a look so we can see everything. It's all here. So I've got actually quite a lot of information here. So I've brought the entire thing in. I have a look around and I say, okay, well, let's get rid of some of this information. Now, because I've referenced it, I can actually turn off things like the messing model or the stories. I can't remember whether I've actually created this correctly and put my site model in the right layer. I probably didn't. But you can see there, and I've got furniture, so I should have classes. So I can find my IFC furniture and turn that off. So furniture main, preview that, so you can see I can turn off my furniture. And so I can now reference. So I've got a client who's working with an architect, a landscape client, and this would have been so useful for her to bring in those, reference in the IFC files, work on her landscape, and every time the architect updates the drawing, just have it referenced again. It would have been so cool. Someone's asked me a question. Will the PDF compression do away with PDF layers that may have been imported? I'm sorry, I have no idea whether that's going to do that or not. You'd really have to try it. I noticed there's some people from Vectorworks online. Maybe they could answer that question for me. Will the PDF compression do away with PDF layers that may have been imported? So if I understand it correctly, James, what you're talking about is you've imported a PDF into your file. You're now re-exporting an entire PDF, and you want to know whether the layers that were in the first import are going to be carried through. That's correct. Cool. That's correct. Okay. So I don't know if someone else knows the answer to that, but if you do, put a question online for me and I'll give James the answer. So that's the IFC. I wanted to talk about some other things that I use a lot. One of them is the notes manager. Now I use notes a lot in my drawings. So let's find a section that's got notes in it. Cool. This one has, so I've actually got all my notes on a, because I tend to do my sections like this. So there's a lot of notes that I've got here. And I've got a particular manufacturer's material here. Now, I might find that I have to reconnect to my note database. We'll see. So just bear with me if I have to do that. So it hasn't found my note database. So I'm going to have to go find that. So I'm just going to do that on my other screen. And I'll connect it to that. So I've connected it to another database that I know I can mess around with. So let's say, for example, this is the note here. This is a Highland Tray Roofing, and I've named it Corrugated Roofing. So let's say I change the manufacturer of this. So this is now Diamond Corrugate Roofing. So Diamond Corrugate Roofing on self-supporting building paper, and for some reason we need to put netting underneath this. So it's on netting and it's on purl and screw fixture rafters with 14 gauge. There we are, that should do. I just keep spelling it wrong. Oh, that's better. Okay, so I go, okay, let's update that. We'll add that, do I need to add that note to the database? I guess I do. So let's go okay to that. Now I had a whole lot selected, did I? No, I only had the one selected. So that should have, so when I do that, it should update. I did this the other day, didn't I, Barbara? And it just updated the one for me. So you can see that's, I've done it this time. So that note there, on netting has actually updated here as well. So let's change that to what it should say, which is Diamond. Cool. So that's my Diamond Roofing updates there. That one there should have been connected. It should have updated that one as well. This one over here should have updated. So what should happen now is if I go back and add that to the database, they should all update. Now this is actually using a project database from a real life project and I don't want to change it, but it's fantastic that it updates these notes automatically. Now you may not see it on my screen at the moment, but you've got to trust me, this actually works perfectly. So I like that a lot, that note manager. I really like the idea that it updates all of your notes together when you do it. So I don't want to do it, I don't want to do any more of that, but that to me is a really powerful change. For previous versions of Vectorworks, you'd have to go to text, you'd have to go reconcile notes, but now the ability to have them updated live straight through, I think is fantastic. So thank you for that. It's going to save me so much time. Now I'd like to talk to you about data visualization. So before we go into another topic, are there any questions I need to answer about what we've covered so far? Because now we're going to go into data visualization and we're going to go into animation. So I'm going to spend a little bit of time on data visualization because I think it's quite powerful. I'm also going to explain it. So it doesn't look like there's any other questions. So here we've got a situation with a city. This is my capital city, Wellington, and I've got the central business district. So you can see I've got quite a few objects in here. If we select them, there's 800 objects and each object has information attached to it. So if I select one of these objects at random, we know, or we can see that there is a property information attached to that. There it is there, property record, it's got the object, it's got the parcel. And I'm going to open one that I've got with called maps. Where's it gone? These ones here. So I've also got another one where I've added earthquake zone information to these. Let me just find that, Barbara. I did have it open a second ago. There it is, maps. Here it is. So it's the same one, but I've added extra information to it. So here I've got both the footprint. So I've got the height, I've got the age of the building, I've got the elevation of the top of the building. I've also got an earthquake zone for these as well. So we've always had the ability in Vectorworks, we have for a very long time, to modify these objects based on the records attached. So let's just go through that because it's an introduction to data visualization. So if we go to Tools, Records, there's been this option here, Modify by Record. So this has been there for some time. And it allows us to make changes. So for example, I can choose a color value based on the record called zone. And I've got earthquake zone information attached to these. And you can see how quickly it changes all of my objects to represent that data visually for me. Now the downside of this is that it is destructive. And that if I select one of these objects, you will find that it's actually changed physically that object. It's completely changed the color of that object. There are still times where this is fantastic. So let's go back to records and modify by record. Now, if these buildings also have heights, let's do elevation and we'll extrude these based on the elevation, which is really cool. When you think about it, it's just modeled my entire city in no time at all. It's fantastic. But for changing the colors of things, that can be destructive or it's an intrusive way of doing it. And the downside of that is if you want to build maps like this, you can't use Modify by Record because it will change all of those together. So what's different? Vectorworks have previously had a thing called data visualization that worked inside viewports, but they also work outside. But let me show you them in a viewport first. So here I've got a viewport. I've got two that are almost identical. We go over here to my object info palette and there's a data visualization pop-up. And in this current document, I've got several that I've set up already. Things like the building age, the building height, the decade built, and the earthquake zone. And one of the really cool things about these is that, I don't know if you guys have been noticing, but as I changed the data visualization, it actually labeled it for me as well. Now this label is on a annotation part of the viewport, and you can bring that into your current crop area. And there it is, there's my label already on there. I don't have to do anything else. I can select the next one, and then I can say, let's create the decade built. And there it is there. And again, double click on that, and I can drag that into my viewport. I can just move it wherever I find it most convenient. That is really powerful. Now, this is a non-destructive way of changing the information, because if I go back to the original design layer, none of this has been changed. So to me, that's a really cool trick. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to go through how we make these and how we manage them. So what I'm going to do is go to my data, manage these. I'm going to get rid of the earthquake zone because that's a really easy one to recreate. So let's delete that one. Let's delete it so you can see I've lost it over here. So let's make one of those. We're going to make a new one. We're going to call it earthquake zone. I live in an earthquake zone country. So what do we want? Do we want to find everything? Because we can actually define what objects we want to look for. Do we want to look for all objects? Do we want to just look for objects on a specific layer, a specific type of object, a class? Since I'm using a record to modify this information, I'm just going to leave it on all objects. But I could, if I want to, be very delicate about how I focus the visualization. So I could only choose to visualize certain layers of my file, which would be quite cool. So we're going to do all objects, including components of groups and symbols. Yeah, let's do everything. So now what are we going to do? So here's where we actually start to make changes. We're going to choose objects based on their record. So I can use a parameter, I could use an IFC entity, I could use a function, but for this case, I'm going to use a record because I have the red, green, and white zones for my earthquake. So the earthquake's only got one zone. I could use, for example, the building footprints, and that would give me the ability to do things like the height, or what they call the elevation. And there's all the elevations of all my objects. So it's actually gone and counted them all up. It is really quick the way that does all this stuff. So back to my zones, earthquake zones, yeah. So red, we want red to be red. So I'm going to apply attributes. Now, one of the tricks I often forget to do is I forget to tick this. And so I always go through the whole process and then wonder why it's not working. But make sure you apply the attributes. These are going to be green. I'm going to choose a green color. I've just got to go to my other screen. For some reason, my attributes palette always turns up over there when I'm doing a webinar. I'm going to choose a green color. There we are. Green, sweet. How about red? So let's choose red. So apply attributes. We're going to choose a solid color. We're going to make it red. And the other thing I'm going to do with red is I'm going to change my line weight so you can see it. Okay, and white, we want to apply attributes. We want to give them a solid color and we'll give them a white color. Okay, why don't we give those a heavy line as well? That way you'll notice it's done something. And we'll make that blue. Cool. So the apply button is ticked. If the apply button is not ticked, then it won't apply that information. So let's just try that. Okay, so here we'll do the earthquake zone again. Data visualization, earthquake zone. And you'll notice that my white earthquake zones have got the heavy blue line, but the green hasn't been applied. So let's go back and we'll edit our data visualization. So earthquake zone, let's edit that. Let's apply the green again. And now I've got the green as well. So it's, I think, could just be me, but I think it's really quick to do this kind of change. And it's really phenomenal. Now, the ways that you can use this is just about unlimited. And those of you that know me, sometimes you've been to a webinar where I actually do a webinar where I'm talking about this kind of thing, where you can color plants based on the month they need to be pruned or the month that they need fertilizing. So you could have a cityscape like this and you can actually visualize things based on the record. You could have a record called month to fertilize and you can actually color them so that you can see them easily and give that drawing to someone so they could go out and do the work on a large landscape, just focusing on the trees that you want them to. So to me, there's almost no end to what you can do with this data visualization. Let's go to, what do I call it, Barbara? I had it open, didn't I? Here it is. So here's my other one. It's a little object I've been playing with. So here's another situation. So we're working on a building, and at the moment you can see in this building, it's really easy to see the difference between my old walls or my block walls and my timber walls inside. If I go to a 3D view, yeah, it's really easy. You can see I've got internal walls and I'll get external walls. What's not so easy to see is the differences between existing and proposed. Now I could color them differently, I could put different textures, but maybe for creating my visuals, I don't want to see a difference between those new and the old walls. So this is the new button up here, which is the data visualization button. This is where we can use that data visualization concept and we can apply it to design layers. I've got one here called renovation project. And I've colored my renovation so that blue is proposed and red is existing. And I just think that's fantastic. If we go upstairs, it's so easy now to see the differences between my existing walls and my proposed walls, and it's just really quick. Of course, if I turn that off, let's go back to none. Yeah, maybe you could see it, but maybe it's not as clear. And this is only a small project. On a very large commercial project, this could be a real benefit. Maybe not just new and existing. What about showing other things like whether it's got a fire rating? Whether it's got a special finish on the wall, that kind of thing. this is going to be so useful for changing our drawings. And I think once we get used to it, I think we're going to use this a lot in viewports to create the kinds of drawings that help to describe our buildings more fully to our consultants. So I'd like that a lot. Hope you guys like it as well. One of the other things I did discover with this was, I don't know if you guys notice it here, but I've actually got these in my user folder. So you can export these data visualizations to a library and then use them on every project. So let me show you that. Let's manage my data visualization. Let's delete that. Let's say, for example, I've started a brand new project and I haven't got the one that I want. And I go, I'm doing a renovation project. I can go to my user folder. It's right here. I can choose it and it just brings it straight into my current file straight away. Really cool. And that to me is is one of those really neat benefits. Instead of it just residing in the current file, it's everywhere. It's really cool. So I think that's nearly everything that I wanted to cover. The last thing I really wanted to talk about, it hasn't taken as long as I thought really, but and there doesn't seem to be any questions. Interesting. Okay, so the last thing I was really going to talk about a lot was this ability to change or create animations, which I really like. So for architects and landscapers, this is going to be so cool. So I've got a project here. Let's just have a little look around it. And you can see I've got a project. I've got a little house that I'm planning here, and it's on a hill and it's quite steep. And I'd kind of like to make a walkthrough. So let's have a look at this. I'm going to make a path. So I'm going to draw a path. So I'm going to start here. I want to walk up and let's say, for example, it's a landscape. I want to come up here and I want to walk around my building and I want to walk through my garden and I'll stop here. And when I stop, I want to look out over my new house. So first of all, I've drawn a path using the polyline tool. If I double click, I can grab hold of that path. I can drag it around. I can add or subtract nodes or handles. So I can get rid of that one there. And I can pull those handles around or those nodes around. And I can make it do sort of what I'd like. So I can make it walk through that garden area. Very good. But that's not really the cool bit. The cool bit is when you go model, create animation, and we create a walkthrough we're going to create a walkthrough path from my selected object. This is a really quick way to make a walkthrough. It's thinking, and the reason it's thinking, now I did this yesterday and I made a slight mistake. What happens is one of these handles, this one here, is outside my model. So what I want to make sure of is when I edit that, I bring that inside my site model. Because that way it won't put my, because what I found was happening was the camera was actually going from here on the site model down to zero. So let me do that again. Let's create that path. So it's thinking about it, because what it's doing is actually measuring the surface of my site model and it's making my path relative to my site model. So let's just play that. Should come up the road, change the view, and stop there. Cool. Let's skip backwards. So I've got some controls over here. So I'm going to activate that camera view. And you can see I'm looking up the path. So let's play that. It's just so easy. I just think that is so cool and so easy to make that path. So let's go back to that. So it does a fantastic job of doing that for me. So I'm going to select that object. There's a little blue handle or a little blue node here on the end of this camera. I'm going to move that to look over this house here. Cool. Now let's skip backwards. Let's play that camera again. And what we should notice is as it gets close to the top, the camera starts rotating. And you can see that the camera rotated and the camera rotated to look over here. Let's go back a little bit. So this area here, these are called keyframes. And the keyframes actually relate to these little blue handles. And so if I grab that camera from this point and I look back at that house over here again, now the reason I'm using the top of that house is because it's something consistent that I can grab hold of. So let's go to the previous, so that one there, let's play the camera. And you can see the camera starts turning and it looks at that house. So let's go all the way back to the beginning. And let's activate the camera view and let's play it. So this is live rendering in OpenGL, which is pretty quick. Now I've made a mistake because at that point that it starts rotating around. So what I have done though, is I've created a sample. So let me just find my sample. It's on my other screen. I'll just open it up and I'll show you. Now, I won't play the entire movie. It's about 40 seconds long. It was pretty quick to create. There's my test file there. Let's test file movie. Here it is. So here's my movie. I created about 40 seconds long. I'm not going to play the entire thing, but it actually walks up really slowly, really lovely, and it gradually turns. And you can see just at this point here, the camera actually tips up before I start walking up the hill. The camera tips up so that it looks like I'm truly walking up. And then I climb up, and then the camera follows the ground really well. And then just at the end, the camera turns and it looks over the sea, which is really neat. And it's just so quick. It is so easy to make. So the other thing we can do with that, let's do another one. So that was one of the walkthrough one, which I think is really quick. I've also done this on a, so one of the things I was talking, particularly my landscape clients, I was talking about is if you build your landscape and you put steps in it and you make the path go over, then it does a really cool job. Now there are some questions. What's that question? So there's a question about the data visualization. With data visualization and new existing walls, would you use it rather than separate classes for new and proposed? Good question. I don't know. Traditionally, I always use classes, but depends on the drawings you need to make. So you might have to use both. So in if we go back to my data visualization, which one was it? This one? No. That one. Let's go back to this drawing here. If I've got any drawings, I'll show you what I mean. So if we go back to an existing drawing, I'm not sure that data visualization is going to allow me to turn objects on or off, which is what I often use classes for. Demolition plan. Now it should allow me to do something like a demolition plan where I can change the graphic style of the objects to be demolished. Now, traditionally I've used classes for that. I'll probably continue to use classes for a while until I really get used to using those. So I hope that helps. So back to my test file. Okay, so there's another one that I wanted to do, which was, I wanted to show you this other one, which was the rotate, create animation, and it's the orbit path. So let's do center of selection. I've selected my house already. And so it's done an orbit path around my selected object. But you'll notice that my path is a little bit low on the ground. So there's nothing on here that suggests that I can change its elevation, but I can move it in 3D. So I can go modify, move 3D. And I can choose an elevation. Now I know the elevation of my building was about 40 meters above ground. So let's make it about 45 meters. And there it is, there's my view. So I can always change this if I want. But also if I double click on this path, it activates the reshape tool. And if I use this mode here, this is the last one, I can change the elevation of part of my path. And now this might make it more like an amusement park ride, but we'll see. So let's play our view. Yep, that's really uncomfortable. So you can see where I made the changes, you can actually change the elevation. So my suggestion would be don't change it too, like I did, unthoughtfully. Actually make some thought to how you want to do that. And to make an animation that starts and walks around and flies around the building, that is also really easy to do. You just draw the path and gradually zoom in. There are other techniques we can use like animation works, but this is actually really cool, really quick. Now someone did ask, once we've done that, how do we make the movie? So we select our object. Down here there's a button for called Create Movie. Let's click on that. So there's my duration. So I actually chose 40 seconds for the duration of my movie, 30 frames a second, what rendering style do I want to use, what quality, do I have special settings that I want to use for OpenGL, time range, do I want to just do a part of it or the whole movie, what frame size do I want, I can do small ones, I can do large ones, I can do 4K if I like. So you make those choices at this point, then you save the movie, and that's how I got the one that I got. Does the animation automatically follow the terrain? Yeah, it does. I didn't change that. It just automatically followed it. If you want to really test it, why don't we make one that flies over meshing models, and that'll give you an idea. So let's start here. We'll fly straight over the meshing model at my building. And we'll make that one into an animation. So that one missed my buildings, but it follows my site model. Thank goodness it didn't follow my buildings. That would have been really awkward. So again, thanks Vectorworks, because that is something that I wouldn't have thought of. If I do need to follow my buildings, don't forget I can still double click on that and I can still edit the elevation of that thing. The elevation paths don't have to be a 3D polygon to start. It starts off as a 2D or as a polyline object. Doesn't have to be a polyline object, but I'm not sure I'd want to use a closed object. So someone said they're trying to create that animation, but they don't have those sub menus that I have. Did you select a path? Just make sure you've got the path selected. So if I haven't got anything selected, I go to model, create animation. I've got something selected, have I? Make sure I haven't got anything. So create walkthrough path from selection, no valid object. So it just needs to be a line. It can be a polyline, it can be a polygon. Polyline is better because it turns the corner more nicely, that's all. So I think that animation tool is really cool. So we were looking at this just a minute ago. So one of the things I do like about this, about the window door object is, and I haven't got time to cover this in a whole lot of detail, I think, but we have this ability in Vectorworks to show a detail level, medium level detail and high level detail. And high level detail, you can actually see the width of my glass on my windows. I think this is fantastic. So that for some drawings, you're gonna have low level detail, and then you might go to another drawing. So it's my existing plan, site plan, demolition plan, foundation. Let's go to my upper floor general. This upper floor general, where I've got a lot more information, maybe I should be showing high level detail, and it really improves the quality of the windows. That to me is one of those little tiny little thing. I just think it's really cool. So that's about all I've got for them today, Barbara. I know it's not the full hour session, but those are my benefits.
Oh, that was plenty. From what I hear around is that the changes are more subtle, I'd say, in Vectorworks 2020, but the improvements look like significant. So
yeah.
Yeah, great. Well,
Vectorworks have done a lot of a lot of work under the hood, I guess.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's changes to the Vectorworks graphics model. There's improvements in rendering, and you know, when you just don't tend to notice, but you look at this object, you go, let's skip backwards, let's activate the camera view, and then now Vectorworks is doing a lot of work. They've spent a lot of engineering trying to get this to work more easily for me, and this works really smoothly. You know, so that they've, yeah. So I'm really happy. I must admit, when I first saw some of the changes, I wasn't quite sure. But those things I've shown you, I think that they're a real benefit. So, and I think I always think it's worth upgrading, because you always need these new things. You don't realize that they're changing these things, these little bits. They're really cool.
Yeah.
So that's all I've got for you. So I just wanted to remind some people that, in case you don't know who I am, I've got this knowledge base, which is full of movies, and I keep updating it so that, for example, the other day I updated something about windows and doors. So window and door settings, some of my clients want to know all about the windows and doors. So I added a movie going through right through the detail of what all those windows and door settings are. I've also got my YouTube channel. Now, just ignore all these scooter movies and stuff. But what I wanted to show you, Barbara, is that I've put my 2017 Vectorworks Fundamentals course. So if you're getting started with Vectorworks or you've forgotten some of the basics, have a look at this. It's all my movies from 2017 Fundamentals course. I wrote a course for the Indian distributor, this Vectorworks Asia, this Architect Asia course. Have a look at these, have a look at this playlist, play through these because they show you how to build stuff in Vectorworks. Okay, I know that they're old, you know, they're 3 years old now, but a lot of these concepts are still really valid. So they're still really useful. And I came across this old 2011 concept modeling manual the other day. And again, you look at it and you go, well, it's what's that, 9 years old? Surely it's still not, but there's still some stuff in there that's really useful to know. And it goes through site modeling. The Architect Asia has site modeling as well. And play these movies, please. They're really useful. They're free. You can go and get them. And
you
some
can
people.
Binge. It's better than Netflix.
Please binge watch. Now, the other thing that, in case you don't know, they're there are these getting started movies. And these were actually designed for educational facilities, so for schools and things. So they wanted something where they could give them to school kids, high school students, let them play with Vectorworks, just having movies to let them play. And this one builds a house like this one without any walls, doors, or windows. So it's like using Vectorworks in a very sketch-up-y way. So have a play of that. It's been quite popular, that movie. So have a look at those. So yeah, ignore the ArchiCAD and the scooter movies if you want.
We love the scooter
movies. By all means, if you want to play the scooter movies, have a fun, because I go out once a month with a bunch of old men on our scooters and we have a bit of fun.
Right.
Wanda says that she loves the new knowledge base. So thank you very much, Wanda. It's been a lot of work, but I think it's so much quicker to search for things now. I just like the way that it structures the things as well. So if we have a look at something like layers and classes or project sharing, I think the 3D modeling, there's a lot of 3D modeling stuff here as well. And so what I did was I put my, instead of making a course, it's all my 3D modeling stuff is now here. And it just means it's somewhere I can keep it updated. And since I'm not logged in, you can't see the entire thing, but it's really cool. Thanks, Barbara.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you. Yes, I'm going to take the screen back in a second so I can show you where you can get updated with Vectorworks 2020. Just go to novedge.com and or give us a call. We're always happy to talk to you. And Novedge is changing the way designers purchase 3D software. We have all the choices and great advice. So you don't have to second guess yourself. Am I getting the right version? There's always somebody you can talk to and can advise you. And to rewatch today's webinar, you can go to YouTube or Vimeo and binge watch there as well. Thanks again, Jonathan. This was great. Have a wonderful rest of the day. And thanks for watching, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thanks for having me. Thanks, everyone, for giving up your time.